There was a slide showing a thing which has gone. So can you reconnect?
Slide is what is showing, Dr. Sanjeev. We are able to see your slides.
Oh, is it? I am unable to see.
Yeah, we can see. We can see. Patient reported outcome, PROM and PRIM.
Right. Perfect. So, as I was mentioning to Mr. Raj, that with so many stalwarts in the panel, and how do we bring in from a top level HPI's journey, NABH journey, and CAHO's journey into a very, very micro level of work in quality. But nevertheless, I think possibly it fits into the winds of change, and we'll talk about patient reported outcome measures and experience measure. And we are so glad that this has been included into the fifth edition of NABH as well. So we'll be speaking on that. The agenda would be that is there a change in the balance of power, because most of the success stories or success percentages come from the surgeon driven success rates, and he or she says that my primary angioplasty rates, the positive rates, or the 5-year survival rate of breast surgery or knee replacement rate has been 97% to 98%. But who decides that? So that is the change which we are envisaging when PROM and PREM comes into place. So the patient experience and how did we deploy it? We have been doing it since 2017. And we are thankful for Angelina, who came from ICOM and who had helped us to establish this close to 3 years back. So the patient journey in the hospital is generally like this. When they are sick, they come to the hospital. They undergo surgery, they are shifted to post-op recovery. When they are doing well, they get discharged. Then they go home, and the document which links the patient to the hospital is the discharge summary. But what is also important to understand is there are few things which are still missing. There are no clinical handover during this journey. So the patient feels bad, or he or she is sick. And that is how they come into the hospital, and then they go back into the community. We don't hand them over to another practitioner to take care of their chronic illnesses. There is no longitudinal follow-up. So if they are forced to come for a review at 3 weeks, 3 months, 6 months, and that's it. So we don't know how they are doing, and have they improved, and is it just a quantitative improvement, or is there a qualitative improvement? Experience recording has been also missing. So we right now, it is the physician or the hospital says, this is my key performing indicator, but we actually don't know what exactly is the scenario. And we also know that there are challenges in the communication when the patient comes to the hospital. We interrupt a patient every 23 seconds, and that's what was reported in JAMA. The patient comes with a story, and 50% of the time we don't record those story, because we are so prone to solving the physical problems that we don't want to get into the psychosomatic aspects at all. We don't inform less than a 1 minute about, we don't invest time on explaining the prescription, whether they have understood or not. And our pharmacy college students went for a home health visit and realized that 42% of the patients, this is in Kerala, which is 98% literate, they had no adequate information about taking prescriptions properly, and they were not doing that. And they do get intimidated with the white coat syndrome. And if they have 10 questions, they are left with one when they are seeing the doctor. And so shared decision making is not visible. So there is a body which is called as International Confederation of Health Outcome Monitoring, and along with a business, Harvard Business School, they came up with this idea of measuring the patient experience and outcomes 1 year post-discharge and 2 years post-discharge. And right now, there are close to 35 order sets which are already there, like order sets of pregnancy, childbirth, IBD, overactive bladders, colorectal cancers, craniomaxillo. So there are almost every inch of super specialization areas have already been covered. And then there is where you have a particular format and then you follow those patients accordingly. So it was soon taken up by National Quality Forum, and then they also in 2013 released a standard where they made it mandatory. So it's mandatory for Center for Medicare and Medicaid, and it has been part of the value-based purchasing in US, but it is now also part of National Health Services in UK. So it is so good to see that now through NABH, India would also see a lot of data with respect to PROM and PREM. We all know this gentleman. He has been a fantastic crusader, Ernest Cotman, a general surgeon at Harvard Medical School. But look at the year 1917, almost a century back, and he he's the founder of American College of Surgery, and we have seen fantastic work during COVID, which they've come up with so many good guidelines. And he also was a founder of JCO, and which is so popularly known as JCI. What he said was, every hospital should follow every patient it treats long enough to determine whether or not the treatment has been successful. And he said that almost a century back, and he's known as an end result surgeon. But what happened to him is a sad story, that even at Harvard, he was the acceptance was very poor, and he was he moved out, and he went to Yale, and there again he moved out. But then he is definitely one of those path-breaking surgeon who brought it a superb concept where patient is at the forefront. Now, Harvard Business Review also talks about outcomes. So how do you measure outcome? Is it just the hospital stay? And most of the hospitals now are at 3.8 to 4.2 ALOS. So is it just that which determines the outcome, or it's much more beyond that? Because you never know whether the patient goes to the local hospital or are still seeking healthcare back to a tertiary care setup, which may not be the case. So it's the value addition, and value being defined as quality divided by cost, is what determines an outcome, and that is again very important. And there is so much of powerful literature which is available with respect to patient reported outcome measure, which is supposed to be the way forward, and possibly this is the winds of change. So Amrita's experience have, why did we start with PROM? Because we also realized when the patients during the longitudinal follow-up, and we did a project with clinical handover with Government of Kerala and University of Birmingham, and trying to adopt and adapt to NHS model. And we realized that when we reach out to our own patients who were discharged from Amrita, that there was no shared decision-making, and we didn't do appropriate follow-up. And then there are some patients who were going to the local hospitals and they were not doing well. So other than the cancer registry, which was very active, there was other illnesses, NCDs, which was not being measured. But then we also looked at evidence. So is there an evidence, and how do we improve on that? So there are lots of systematic reviews which have been done. Do patients' expectation influence treatment outcomes? And a lot of work has been done in most of the surgical departments, because these order sets are available, and plus the formats to capture PROM is also available. And it basically, what it does is a comprehensive integration, because it is just not limited to the hospital stay, but it is 1 year to 2 years of follow-up, which is also extremely important. So this again would be the best practice, because this is a new tool. And here you are actually making patient come at the center of healthcare delivery. But then there are two angles. One is his experience and his outcome, and how we can club both of it together, that his experience is good, but yet the outcome is phenomenal, and it is benchmarked to all international standards. And this also is broken down into his experiences linked to performance indicators, his patient reported outcomes, and linked to surgical or non-surgical outcomes. So that is how it becomes a very holistic tool, which is very important. So there is a 6D model of health outcomes, which deals with death, disease, disability, discomfort, dissatisfaction, and cost of care. And this is what is generally is being seen within the hospital. So death and disease is the clinical outcomes, and that we measure. Patient-reported outcome is the disability and discomfort, and then there is a dissatisfaction. And all of this 6D of health outcome is done very well, measured very well with PROM and PRIM. And quality of life assessment is what was missing in our healthcare delivery system, because we are very quantitative in our approach, that we don't do those regulated interviews, observations, and focus group discussion to understand quality. Are we making qualitative difference? And is DALI and QALY also being captured? So the design which we adopted at our center was that we introduced PROM and PRIM at antibiotic stewardship, because this is one of our flagship programs. And at a select department, which is gastrosurgical and cardiovascular, we introduced a tool which is ethnography and sociogram, because we were pretty strong with the social sciences group. And orthopedics, knee and hip replacement, cardiovascular, CABG, and critical care. And this was done from 2017 onwards. And so we follow up according to the format which has been given by ICOM and Harvard Business School at the time of discharge, 3 months post-discharge, 6 months, 1 year, and then 2 years. And who did the follow-up was all these beautiful people who are medical social worker who do the psycho, socio, and financial analysis of every patient, because we have a fleet of 38 of them who round who participate in clinical rounds, and they were the one who were following up at discharge and up to 1 year. So how did they follow up? We developed a mobile app which was very handy, and it was available also in a vernacular language. And they were taught, while they were admitted, they were taught how to address the issue of PROM and PRIM when they get into when they are discharged. So they need to get some of the demographics which should match with our medical records, and then how do they score? And this was taught before they get discharged. So like in orthopedics, there is a who's and who's scoring pattern. So knee injury and osteoarthritis outcome score, and hip injury and osteoarthritis outcome score. So it looks at every bit of activity, rising from bed, putting up the socks, rising from sitting, bending to floor, squatting. Would you say your health is excellent? Because it's very qualitative, and then you have been taught at the time of discharge, how do you assess the similar pattern? So during the past 4 weeks, how much of time has your physical health or emotional problem interfered? So it was right now, I don't want to demean the surgical group, but you are under so much of pressure of performing those surgeries or utilizing your operation theater that less time is being spent on psychosomatic. So, and that is what PROM brings about that change. Similarly, for CABG, there is for all cardiac services, there is another format which is available, which is EQ5D5S, which looks at mobility, self-care. And this is very, very important when you have comorbidity and you've got a very difficult surgery done. So do you have slight problems of dressing yourself and your usual activity, which will cover work, study, housework, family, and leisure activity? Because there needs to be a comprehensive change if the patient has been selected well and has the care has been delivered well with respect to anxiety, depression. And then there is a scaling pattern which has been taught to them at the time of discharge. And then this is the experience bit. So you look at our outcome bit, and you also look at the experience, patient reported experience measuring, where you measure your experience at 3 months, 6 months, and 1 year and 2 years. Does making you feel at ease? So what is the communication good enough? Letting you tell your story, because it is very important, not just at the time of decision of your surgery in an outpatient, but throughout the journey. are you able to tell your story, which is so very important. The positive regard for the patient is important. And listening, fully understanding your concern throughout the journey, it is just not limited to your hospital stay, being positive, explains things properly, and have you been taken into control. So it's very exhaustive tool, but it is extremely effective. I'll briefly take over to the application bit. We introduced this in an antibiotic stewardship where we where the clinical pharmacist and the social scientist, they round with the surgeons. And what we generally see, ours is a university teaching hospital, and what we saw is a very hierarchical way of rounding. So there is a head of department who comes, and this is in a cardiovascular thoracic setting, where he takes most of his information from the surgical resident, who they assume has taken round before the head of department and other assistant and associate professors have come in. And there is hardly any discussion with the patient, and we say that we are a patient-centric hospital, and there is few clarification which comes from the carer, and some bit of information comes from the nursing in charge, who was also not present at the night before, and the most of the story which has been shared is about the previous night, how the patient has done well. Rest of the people are mute spectators, and we did it for antibiotic stewardship and infection control. There is no discussion with respect to antibiotic initiation, de-escalation, continuation, and infection prevention measures. And this is what we take back to these surgeons, and we are assuming an intervention which leads to behavioral change. Similarly, for gastro surgical department, slightly different, but still very hierarchical. There is a senior surgeon who gets most of his information from surgical resident. And then rest of them, they are part of the team, but they are not contributing. And it is so different in our country that most of this information about the patient comes from the carer. So we say that we are a patient-centric hospital, but in India, I think that's a Western concept. We are a patient and a carer-centric hospital. And that is what is important. There's very minimal information comes with from the patient. Maximal interaction is between the nurse and the senior surgeon from the carer. And still, if you see antibiotic discussion and infection control discussion is hardly there. So we take this back to the surgeon and tell them this is how you behaved. And initially it was not taken well, but now it is all accepted. And this is how we are trying to change the behavior of conducting the rounds and taking patients into consideration. So post round, patient is interviewed, and about this scenario, he is asked whether he is satisfied or he would like to see the change. And that is how the behavioral change about every aspect of the treatment and patient being the center is being done. So we realize that training is not helping, and training along with social science and behavioral change, which would be important. And we published this in the Frontiers of Social Sciences. How is it helping us? We are seeing a tangible change. The prescription patterns for antibiotics is better. The all-cause mortality has reduced. The length of stays have come down. And there is a decent cost benefit about 1.2 CR. And this also we have published in the Infectious Disease Society of America journal. So we also introduced PROM at Orthopedic Department of Orthopedics, which where 1,130 patients of osteoarthritis knee were there, and 101 hip replacement patients were there. What we did was activity of daily living, and there are five elements, then the recreational activity and pain. And we saw that post introduction of PROM, there is a 400% increase, 300 to 400% increase in activity of daily living. And that is the appreciation which the patient has. There is a recreational activity increase of close to 300%, and there is a 600% down of their pain and the discomfort, which is very key for their improvement. Similar results were there with the hip replacement, where post PROM and PREM implementation, the activity of daily living improved. Most of it gets missed, and they possibly assume that this is what the best they can get post surgery. The surgical time in the hospital was not stormy, but this is what was the recovery. And pre, it was 10, and there is close to 400% improvement in recreation and similar improvement in pain and discomfort. So other than that, we also saw in critical care, pre and post, we measured all of it in Apache 4. And then the standardized, when we started all the process, the standardized mortality rate was 0.8%. And we followed a select group of patients who entered into the critical care on activity of daily living. There is a remarkable improvement on recreational scale, close to 250% improvement. There's an improvement with the quality of life scaling and visual analog scale. Similar scenario was there in cardiovascular. Remember, we follow a different format, EQ5D5S, 5L. And functional daily living, recreational score, visual analog score, and quality of life, there was a significant improvement with respect to all aspects post implementation of PROM and PRIM. And there is a significant improvement in satisfaction level and net promoter scale level. We also did the similar experiment with Harvard Global Health, where we were doing a bit of our clinical audit, and we reached out to the patients. Is our clinician adequately mentioning about at the time of discharge and post discharge? And we realized that in American Heart Association guidelines to manage heart failure, there are few benchmarked phenomena which needs to be done. So there are, for investigation, you need to take care of hypertension, diabetes, your daily living, smoking, alcohol. You also need to for diagnostic, pro-BNT needs to be there, which we were not doing too well because the test is costly. But when we reached out to the patient to understand whether the treatment has been explained to them, ACE and ARB inhibitor should be there for 100% of the cases, which we realized it was 55%. And dietary consultations, which is so critical for heart failure patient, which was good, but what was critical was salt and water intake, which was not done properly. So this is how you reach out to the patient at the time of discharge and post that to understand whether every bit, as per the meta-analysis and the best of standard of care, whether everything has been explained and is patient taking all of it regularly. So does this also lead to some economic gain? And that is very key, because ultimately it is important to have that cash flow and measure quality in either reduction of cost or increasing the patient flow. So all cause mortality did improve and length of stays reduced. And what all of it led to is revisit increased by 11% in the departments where we introduced this. There was increase in footfall by 17%, that was in inpatient. Increase in admissions led to almost 48 lakhs of improvement, and that also led to a good word of mouth improvement and patients coming back or the relatives coming back with increased number of surgeries. So total cost benefit was close to 1.6 CR. Definitely, we didn't still accounted for the opportunity cost. So in to conclude, these are disruptive tools, definitely winds of change, and they would be the next blockbuster, because it's no longer just the physician driven or a surgeon driven success rates for the procedure which they do, but it is their engagement which is the key, and the patient perception with respect to health inexperience is extremely important. So PROM and PRIM is an excellent tool in assessing the success of the procedure which is there from their perspective, measuring the quality of life. So thank you very much, Mr. Raj, for giving the opportunity. I'll end with this slide where Hippocrates said it's more important to know what sort of person has the disease than what sort of disease the person has, and that is the holistic care which we need to provide to the patient. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Sanjeev. It was indeed a very detailed presentation on the PROM and PRIM. I'm sure a lot of our participants would have been able to appreciate it and gain a lot of insights, which they would be keen on to discuss with you and implement in all their organizations. With that, we will go on to the next presentation. I would like to call upon Dr. Lalu Joseph for the same. I will just load the slides, madam. Just give me a second. In the meanwhile, panelists can further add insights to the PROM and the PRAME and the organizational objectives which could be achieved out of it.
So this is wonderful wisdom, actually, and he makes it sound so easy, but there's a lifetime of work behind that, actually, because he's so passionate about it and he takes you through the story in a storyboard manner. But these are core areas, actually, and ultimately any accreditation process, if we do not concentrate on outcomes, I mean, that is the goal. Ultimately, you have to devise an outcome-based approach which can lead on to a ranking also, maybe going forward. Maybe India is not ready for a ranking-based system because of diverse nature, but outcome has to be monitored. Our KPIs, which we quarterly ask for, and hospital summit, majority of those are fudged, actually. You know, creative energies at play, but data capture tool. And we'll be very keen to work with such doyens, Dr. Sanjeev and others, to create that system where hospitals can really, you know, share and have a concept of a core quality. So this is a very useful thing which he has just told, and I'm sure all members who are attending will would have benefited already. Wonderful.
Thank you, Dr. Atul.
It's a great presentation, Sanjeev sir, and it's going to be very difficult speaking after you.
Not at all, Lalu.
Yeah, over to you, Dr. Lalu, to take us through.